Welcome, everyone, to Party at the Piers. I'm Chris Flink, the Exploratorium's Executive Director. There's a sign that hangs above the Exploratorium's exhibit workshop. It says, here is being created the Exploratorium, a community museum dedicated to awareness. In recent weeks, a new world is being created in front of our eyes. From a global pandemic to a powerful movement for racial justice, we are seeing ideas and behaviors shift rapidly. What can a science museum do in this moment? The Exploratorium is dedicated to awareness because awareness and curiosity are the first steps to learning and to action. We help light the spark of curiosity in people of all ages. We want curiosity to be a lifelong habit. True curiosity goes beyond accepting a post on social media or believing the first search result you get. It comes from asking questions. These questions are often complex, uncomfortable, and sometimes unanswerable. But these are the questions that drive change. Today, I invite you to experience Exploratorium's mission for yourself. I hope you feel the joy of understanding and discovery. Thank you to our event co-chairs, Roberta and Charles Katz, and to our entire Party at the Piers Leadership Committee for your dedication to helping us reimagine this annual event. Thanks so much to those of you who have already donated to this fundraiser. We cannot do our work without your help. Thank you also to Asset Management, Autodesk, and all of our event sponsors for your generous support. Welcome, and let the show begin.
Hey there, I'm Brian Green, Professor of Physics and Mathematics at Columbia University, and it is really a great honor for me to say some words about the San Francisco Exploratorium. Now, first thing I should say at the outset, the Exploratorium is all about hands-on science, but I am a theorist. I work with equations, mathematics on a page or on a computer, on an iPad, simulations. I don't touch equipment. I don't go near equipment. Everyone's afraid that I will break equipment. But here's the thing. When I first went to the Exploratorium, I don't know when it was. It was probably, 20 years ago. Has it been around that many years? It feels like it was 20 years ago. I went in not knowing what to expect. And it was this spectacular hands-on playground of real science, real physics. So I was like a little kid in there, walking around, playing with all the things that twisted and moved and went up and down. And when I went into the room, I can't remember exactly, or the space that had, I'm pretty sure it was a cloud chamber, where you could actually see the trajectories of particles passing through the device, I stood there for, it must have been a half, it was like for 20 hours or so. I stood there for a long time because it was this moment when I said to myself, holy smokes, those particles that I study with my equations in quantum field theory and gauge theory, the particles, they're real. There they are. I could see the tracks going through the cloud chamber. And it was this really mind-expanding moment for me as an adult. Now imagine that kind of experience for a kid that can really see that science is something not just that you learn in the classroom and you spit it back on an exam and then you leave it behind, but science is all around us. Science can impact the way we engage with the world. Science can change our perspective on reality. That's the kind of experience that kids must have all the time at the Exploratorium. And how spectacular is that? How spectacular is that in the current climate, in the current age, when facts are not respected, where science is not something that is valued at the highest levels of government. So here's the thing, support the Exploratorium, like right now, like get out your checkbook, open up your wallet, because the Exploratorium is the kind of institution that can transform our kids, transform our future. That's how important it is.
So you were at the Exploratorium today, huh?
Yeah, and I found cosmic rays.
Cosmic rays?
Yeah, there's this giant box called a cloud chamber with a window in it. It's old, older than me, older than the Exploratorium itself. Lots of cool dials and switches, but the main part is that you look down into a window and...
What do you see?
Well, if you're patient, you see evidence of cosmic rays that have traveled to Earth from exploding stars in our galaxy.
No way.
Yeah, they're all around us, everywhere. They're invisible and they travel right through everything, including us. But with this box, you can indirectly see the cosmic rays by the cloud-like lines they trace as they speed to Earth.
How big are these cosmic rays?
Really small, subatomic. The cosmic rays, specifically these particles called muons, travel near the speed of light, but the cloud chamber captures their presence. It's like how fluttering leaves of a tree indirectly show us the presence of the wind. Inside the cloud chamber, the air is supersaturated by the combination of evaporated alcohol and dry ice. When particles crash through the resulting vapor, they create, through ionization, what looks like a cloud.
That is some serious science.
It's crazy. It's like a conjured magical world that gives you insight into our own world. There's actually more than just muons creating clouds. There's also electrons, positrons, alpha particles. But you know you've seen a cosmic ray when the cloud line looks long and straight.
Good evening, everyone. I want to welcome you to Party at the Piers. I'm Kumasi Aaron, and I work right across the street from the Exploratorium at KGO ABC 7. I can still remember the first time I got to actually visit the Exploratorium. I was so excited to finally be inside because there's so much to see, so much to do, touch, learn, and experience. I was trying to do it all. And when it closed, honestly, I was not ready to leave. I think the best part about working across the street is being able to have a front row seat to seeing all the kids that make their way into this Exploratorium every day with their schools and with their friends and with their family members. We all know the Exploratorium inspires excitement and curiosity in kids and adults alike. Right now, the museum is living online, but in the months to come, I hope to once again see those curious young faces making their way into the museum, and I definitely want to come back too. So please consider supporting the Exploratorium in any way that you can so that they can recover and reopen soon. Now tonight, we are so excited to bring you just a small taste of what the Exploratorium has to offer. The museum's famous tinkering studio is going to inspire your creativity with some chain reactions. You'll also participate in two science demos with the Teacher Institute that might just change the way you see the world. And we will all get to learn about the history and inner workings of fireworks. You'll also hear from some of the Exploratorium's most famous fans on why places like the Exploratorium make a difference far beyond their walls. I'm so excited to get to all of that. But first, we are making a drink. Clay Reynolds from Sea Glass Restaurant, which is right here on Pier 15, is going to walk us through tonight's signature cocktail. Let's get started.
Hi, my name is Clay Reynolds, and I work here at Sea Glass Restaurant at the Exploratorium, and I am really excited to be with you tonight for Party at the Piers. I'm going to be demoing the Peated Palm Cocktail, which is our signature drink tonight, and hopefully you'll be able to make it right along with me at home and enjoy it through the duration of the program. So, first, let's start with how did I come up with this thing? So I was approached to make a signature cocktail for the party, and I started to think about some things that are quintessential to this place. And the first thing I thought of was the fact that there's some mythology around our founder and his favorite libation. I was not fortunate enough to meet Frank Oppenheimer, but those that did said that he enjoyed a nice single malt from time to time, even so much that there was one always present in his desk for those particularly contentious budget meetings. So I decided to go with Scotch as the base spirit tonight. And following the theme of pure imagination, what is more imaginative than combining Scotch with coconut water? It is something that is not a typical thing found in cocktail bars, but it is remarkably well suited to be paired together. There is a beautiful nutty character to coconut water. It is not too sweet if you're dealing with the pure coconut water products out there. And it really works incredibly well with the peaty, smoky flavors that you find in Scotch. However, there is a problem with coconut water and cocktail making. And that is that it is not a super concentrated juice, unlike some other things. And when you add it as an ingredient and then you dilute those ingredients through the use of ice, whether by shaking or stirring, you end up with something that is less, it's less effective. The flavors of the coconut water get lost, and it tends to be something that is not really even identifiable. So I was challenged with trying to figure out how to make those two things go together and still be effective. And one way to do that was to take the problem and turn it into the solution. And like is said here at the Exploratorium, every question, like how do we make these things work, lends itself to an experiment. So I thought, why not substitute the problematic ice made from water with ice made from coconut water? So what we did was we first found the balance of the drink and the proportions. And then I decided to do the juice shake with the coconut water ice cubes. Now, fortunately for us, most home ice cube trays are fairly standard size, and they're roughly an ounce per cube. So the good news is you don't need any fancy ice molds or cube makers that you might find at your local hipster bar, just the regular old ice cube tray. And we're going to fill that up with your favorite brand of coconut water. I love this harmless coconut water. Anything that you find that is pure coconut water, you're going to want to use. Nothing too sweet. If you're really adventurous and you're fortunate enough to have access to fresh coconuts, go for it. And you can fill your tray up with whatever you have. So we are going to fill these with our fresh coconut water. And we're going to place this in the freezer the night before we are making the drink. So last night. And through the miracle of modern science and editing, we have coconut water ice cubes. So, unlike shaking or mixing with traditional ice cubes, which, thanks to our friend Physics, you can use as many as you want, because there's an equilibrium that's reached between the melting of the cubes and then the cooling of the liquid from the melting of the cubes. So you're going to reach a single temperature no matter how many ice cubes you make. With this particular cocktail, in order for the flavors to be right and for the drink to be balanced, we need to have that final product be exact. So you're going to use 3 ounces of coconut water. Then you're going to take your favorite Scotch. This cocktail will can handle any style. If you like the heavily peated stuff from Islay, typically, feel free to use that. You can use Japanese whiskeys, which are malted whiskeys, blended whiskeys, whatever your favorite thing might be. We're going to use this Pinch, which is one of my favorite blended whiskeys. It's got the heat, the peatiness, but it is not super peat forward. So we're going to use 1.5 ounces of scotch added to our 3 ice cubes. The next ingredient is orange liqueur. Now, orange liqueur falls into 2 primary categories, triple secs and curacao. We're not talking about the tiki bar version, the blue curacao. We're talking about the traditional product. And what differentiates these two things is the base spirit. With triple sec, it's a neutral grain spirit that is used to as the distillate for the orange peels. With the curacao product, they're using cognac or brandy. So there's some oak exposure to the spirit, which gives it great flavor and makes it more simpatico with our scotch. So the most famous version of that curacao style of orange liqueur is Grand Marnier, which is a great liqueur to use for this drink if you have it. If you don't, look for this dry curacao is terrific. Any orange liqueur that is brandy based. All right, so 1/2 ounce of that goes in. The final ingredient is Angostura aromatic bitters. Really, really a great thing to have as part of your home bar repertoire. It is it lends a lot of complexity. A little goes a long way, and it can really be that final touch when you're making a drink at home and you're just like, it just needs one other thing. This very, very well may be it. So just one healthy dash into your cocktail shaker of your aromatic bitters, and we're ready to go. Now, the great thing about this cocktail is you're gonna actually get a workout making it, which will make it all the better when it's time to imbibe. But we need to have these ice cubes dissolve almost completely. So the shaking is going to be a little more extensive than the normal shake. The cool byproduct of that is your tins freeze up and frost up and look super cool for your guests. You can also, if you want to make this a group activity, shake it and hand it off to your buddy to complete the task. But you'll be able to hear when the ice cubes are broken up and you're basically down to kind of a little bit of resistance. It sounds more like a slushy situation going on in here. You want to get those things nice and dissolved so that when you first take your first sip of your cocktail, all the flavors are there and represented and are equally delicious. Now, the longer you shake, the more tight the seal becomes, so you may have to fiddle with it a little longer than extra. Also, all of you may not have cocktail tins at home, and if you don't, that's fine. You just want to get some Tupperware, some kind of sealable container, because we don't want this all over you and your furniture, and you can place the ingredients in that and shake it up and get it all nice and cold and delicious. And then when you finish the shaking, you're going to transfer all the ingredients to your favorite cocktail glass, whether it be a martini, a coupe, or just a traditional rocks glass, and enjoy. The peated palm. Have a great night.
My name is Haven Gurma. I'm a disability rights advocate, speaker, and the author of the book, Haven, the Deafblind Woman Who Conquered Harvard Law. I grew up in Oakland in the Bay Area. And when I was growing up in schools, our schools would take us to museums where everything was don't touch, just look, which is not accessible to blind people. Exhibits were behind glass. There were ropes keeping kids away. How are blind people supposed to learn about history and culture and science? Then one year, they took us to the Exploratorium. And that's the first time that I had hands-on access at a museum. Blind people need to be able to access materials in museums. And I'm so grateful that I was able to experience that. I know lots of kids with disabilities and adults with disabilities around the world never get to experience a museum that has access in multiple formats: physical access, audio access, visual access, digital access. That's what museums should do. We should spread accessibility all over the world. So my gratitude and thank you to the Exploratorium.
The Exploratorium really has such a profound impact on so many people's lives. Also, I hope that Clay's cocktail has put you in a festive mood, because we want to say thank you to everyone who's contributed so far. It has been so good to see so much support. And if you haven't already done so, make sure you visit the URL at the bottom of the screen to make your donation. Now, sitting in the center of the Exploratorium is the Tinkering Studio. It is a workshop for playful invention, investigation, and of course, collaboration. And it's also where you can use your creativity to build something phenomenal, like this, just using everyday materials. But of course, we all know the best way to experience the Tinkering Studio is to build something yourself. Let's check it out.
Hi, I'm Steph Muscat. I'm a museum educator on the Tinkering Studio team. And while we've been sheltering in place at home, we've been building our own chain reaction contraptions.
A chain reaction is a whimsical sequence of contraptions where one thing leads to the next. Artists like Rube Goldberg, Heath Robinson, and Bruno Minari have illustrated absurd machines like this one. They often accomplish a very simple goal, like wiping your chin with a napkin, in an overly complicated series of causes and effects. A chain reaction can do 2 things or 20. It can be a solo project on a kitchen table or part of a collaborative cascade that spans a whole room. They're sometimes simple, sometimes complex, and usually really delightful. So let's look at some real-world examples.
We've been building all different kinds of contraptions with whatever tools, materials, and spaces we happen to have at home. So my contraption for today starts when a piece of toast pops out of the toaster.
It knocks the tongue depressor out of the way, allowing the washers to start cascading down that threaded rod. I wanted to add some sound to my chain reaction. They'll hit that orange ball, letting it roll down the paper towel tube track. That'll knock over the chain of paper clips, which will pull open the steamer basket, hitting the Scrabble domino tiles, hitting the first ball, then the second, which knocks the toilet paper roll and blows some bubbles for the grand finale.
We've been posting invitations to social media so that families and educators can tinker at home with their own chain reactions and then share them with us. We've received videos from all over the world.
Some are simple, built on kitchen tables. Others have built large-scale chain reactions in their backyards and shared them with us. Some even feature guest appearances by pets. Or really make use of the elements in creative ways.
Hey Google, quero café.
We've seen some beautifully overcomplicated ways to accomplish some pretty simple tasks. And along with that joy at the success, also comes persevering through failure.
Hey everyone, that was a fail. Let's try again. Fail. Fail. We did it!
It's just so sweet when it finally works.
Now it's your turn. We'd like to invite you to build your own chain reaction and then share it with us online. You can think about how you might use everyday objects in surprising ways. Maybe you'll build a contraption that tells a story or that communicates a theme, like your love for the Exploratorium. Whatever you decide to build, we can't wait to see it. So please share it with us on Twitter and Instagram using the hashtag Exploratorium. Thank you for your support. We can't wait to see what you build.
Hi, Stephen Colbert here, and I am so happy to be making this little video in support of the Exploratorium. I have a soft spot in my heart for science. First of all, without science, no one would know how to fix the soft spot in my heart. And second, I just find it exciting to get to know things. I mean, and what does science mean? But knowledge. I like the old view of science and philosophy being the same thing, love of knowledge and love of wisdom being the same idea, that as we explore the world, we actually learn things not only about nature, but about ourselves, that knowledge for knowledge's sake has a value. I think there's something to the fact that if I walked into this beach right now and found one of the crabs that lives about 9 inches below the surface of the sand, and when the tide comes in and goes out, as the waves lap over his hole, little fountains of water come up and down. In my mind, I have an imagination about how that crab does it, that his claws are all curved and they slide over each other and they work in a pumping action to drive the water back up and out to keep his little hole clear. And I don't know if that's true, but wouldn't it be fun to go dig it up and to see what the shape of his claws are? Now, it wouldn't prove that I'm right, but it would be a data point toward knowing what the truth of it is. Then, of course, there's the engineering applications. If I happen to turn out to be right about that thing, perhaps there'd be an improved type of pump that I could use, that I could employ to get the water out of my yard as the oceans rise, due to all the people who do not believe in science, ignoring what we've learned for every bit of curiosity before this. So here's to exploring. Here's to knowing. Of course, the ultimate philosophical question, as long as we're blending philosophy and science, is it better to know than not to know? Now, it seems, you know, self-evident that it's better to know, though Oedipus would probably argue the point. We are in the world, and we are part of the world, and by knowing it, we know ourselves. So thank you, science, whoever came up with asking questions. And thank you to the courage of the people who continue to ask the questions, especially the ones that no one wants asked.
I think we can all say thank you and agree with that. The Exploratorium's vision really is a world where people think for themselves and can confidently ask questions, question answers, and just understand the world around them. Sometimes, in order to begin asking those questions, you need to change the way you're actually seeing the world. And teachers do this for their students every single day. Here at the Exploratorium, staff educators offer hands-on professional development to help teachers do just that. Take a look.
Think about this. The children of today will face the complex issues of tomorrow on a global scale. Many of these issues will require scientific, creative, and critical thinking to come up with successful solutions. So, what if the next generation was shaped by creative and courageous educators? This is where the Exploratorium comes in. How, you ask? By teaching the teachers who teach the children to explore in new ways, engage with the world, and make learning joyful, social, creative, unexpected, and courageous. At the Exploratorium, tinkering, exploring, and doing science are at the very core of who we are. We're working to support passionate teachers so they become passionate learners. Because when a teacher is taught to step forward and ask, "What if?" that's when science becomes real for them and their students. The Exploratorium is a critical engine for helping educators around the world to teach and learn with their hands, their hearts, and their minds. So what if learning could be like this everywhere and for everyone? We'd tackle those issues through creating a courageous global community of thinkers and doers. Passionate educators setting the stage for success today and future generations to come. We've accepted the challenge. Will you join us?
Hello, and welcome back to the Exploratorium. Thank you for joining us for this year's online Party at the Piers. My name is Lori Lambertson, and I'm one of the educators here in our Teacher Institute. I want to especially thank you for all of your support, from sharing our online resources with people to help them stay curious, to donating funds so that we may continue our work during this humanitarian crisis. Thank you so much for all you do for us. I'm here at the museum today to take you on a little journey through some exhibit experiences. And you're going to have exhibit experiences right from your own home. Some of the earliest exhibits here at the Exploratorium are about the eye and perception. Normally, at this time of year, the Teacher Institute would be welcoming a group of over 100 teachers to be part of our Summer Institute. One of our early goals in those first few days with this new group of teachers is to create an equitable learning environment and welcome them into our scientific community. They come from all different backgrounds and experiences, and we want each of them to feel like they have a voice in the conversations we have here. One of our favorite ways to do that is to engage them in exploring human perception. Our questions: what do you notice? What do you wonder? What does it remind you of? Don't require any specific scientific background. And each person's unique experience gives them a voice so that we can collaboratively understand what's going on. The first exhibit we're going to look at together from your home is one of my favorites, Adapting to Color. I love this exhibit because it allows us to see the world in a new way. In order to do this exhibit from home, you're going to need to lean in to a screen, whether it's your computer screen or your phone. And it needs to be really close to your eye. There's going to be a green field and a pink field of color, and you're going to have to put your nose right up on the midline between the two. If it's a computer screen, right up that close. And if you're using your phone, I'd recommend wiping it off first before you put it right up next to your face. One eye is going to see only green light, and one eye is only going to see pink or magenta light. Ready? Lean in. I'm going to tell you what to do. Don't stop looking at the pink and green lights. You need to stare at them for about 30 seconds. So I'm going to keep talking, and I'll let you know when to stop. What do you notice? Do you see one color or the other? Do you see a blend of the two colors? Do you see alternating colors? Could you be seeing the dominance of one eye over the other? Keep staring. Now, look up and cover one eye, and then cover the other, and alternate back and forth. Do your eyes see the same? What do you notice? One eye sees the world pink-tinted, and one eye sees the world green-tinted. But wait, when you looked at the green light, how does that eye see the world now? And the eye that looked at the pink light, how does that eye see the world now? They're opposites. The eye that was flooded with green light now sees pink, and the eye that was flooded with pink light now sees green. What's going on? On the back of your eye, we have color receptors called cones. These cones respond to red light, green light, or blue light. Our eyes can detect millions of different colors, but we only have three kinds of cones. When you stare at a green light, the green cones are stimulated. And after a while, they become adapted to that situation. Then when you go to look around at the rest of the world, the eye that was flooded with green light, those green cones have not yet had time to reset, and you see a pink-tinted world. Similarly, the eye that was flooded with pink light was stimulating your red and your blue cones. And so when you go to look at the world with that eye, the red and the blue cones haven't yet had time to reset, and you see a green-tinted world. This was easy to set up on a computer, and you can try this with other colors and find out what colors do you see after you stare at a blue field or a yellow field. Try it and have fun exploring the cones on the back of your eye. The other exhibit we're going to experience is called Floater Theater. Floater Theater was created by artist-in-residence Nina Kachadorian. The Teacher Institute has a classroom version of this that we simply call Floaters. This is one of our science snacks, which are teacher-tested online classroom or home versions of Exploratorium exhibits. If you're not familiar with our science snacks, this collection has hundreds of activities, and it's one of the most popular pages on the Exploratorium's website. I'm going to set you up for this, but we're going to let the voiceover from the exhibit lead you through this experience. As before, this is an experience where you're going to lean way in to your screen. Each person at your party needs their own screen. Lean all the way into your computer screen or put your phone right up against your head so that all you see is a field of white. Let your eyes go into soft focus, and here comes the voiceover to guide your experience.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Floater Theater. In a few moments, the performance will begin, and it stars some most unusual actors, your floaters. I think the orchestra is ready now. Lean very close to the light and relax your eyes. Gradually, little shapes may begin to appear before you, drifting and hovering in space. Did you know that your eyeballs are filled with a jelly called the vitreous humor? Tiny folds and wrinkles in this jelly cast shadows in your eye, and these shadows appear to you as floaters. These shapes aren't on your eyeball, they are in your eyeball. How marvelous. Most people normally have some floaters, but it's possible you might not see any. That might be because your brain has learned to ignore them. But most of the time, you will see them after a little while. It just takes a little patience and careful observation. Floaters can look like almost anything. Strings of pearls, bacteria, a group of emaciated seahorses dancing around a maypole, champagne bubbles, or swarms of bugs, an otter's nest made of vermicelli. And here is one that resembles the skin of a hot dog. And the director of this performance is you. Move your eyes up and the floaters will follow. And then they gently drift down again. Fantastic. For the grand finale, conduct your floaters to the music.
What's going on? As the narrator described, your eye is filled with a clear jelly-like substance called the vitreous humor. And the vitreous humor has bits of dead cells and clumps of protein that cast small shadows onto the retina. We see these as our floaters in our field of view. The floaters are always there, but our brain has learned to ignore them. We can think of this experience as a metaphor for our times. The floaters are always present, just like systemic racism. And like systemic racism, many of us have learned to ignore it. Our brains are very good at ignoring things that don't change. And then, under certain conditions, we notice our floaters, perhaps for the first time. At this time in history, some of us are noticing systemic racism and oppression, perhaps for the first time, though there are many among us who have noticed it and lived in these conditions all of their lives. The Exploratorium's mission statement says that as lifelong learners, educators, scientists, and artists, we must challenge racial injustices and inequities and work toward a world that protects, respects, and celebrates all of its people. The Exploratorium has always been committed to learning and questioning, and now is the time for us to collectively engage in these and work toward a better future. Thank you.
Hi, everybody. I'm Nina Cacciadorian. I'm an artist based in Brooklyn and Berlin, where I am right now. And I wanted to say a little bit today about the fact that I grew up going to the Exploratorium. And I think one of the big things I learned, besides a lot of things that I know get said often about curiosity and about sort of exploring the world, is the importance of understanding something through your hands. And I've had this on my mind a lot because the last week or so, I've developed, you could say, a hobby, maybe, of building paper cacti. And the one that I'm working on now, it's right behind me, it's made of paper drinking straws, and it has a very curious kind of math to it, which I can't say I have the mathematical vocabulary to explain to you, but there is something about making this object that has actually helped me understand something about these forms. And I think that's one of the amazing things that happens when you go to the Exploratorium is you get to experience different kinds of understanding, different kinds of ways to knowledge or to intimacy with a thing or with a phenomenon. And that's really one of the great things that I think I've taken from my many, many visits there. I grew up going there as a kid. I count it as a formative influence and in some ways, even one of the reasons why I think becoming an artist was appealing to me. So please support the Exploratorium. I wish you all the best. I'm a fan from near and as it is right now from far away. Have a really great evening. Bye-bye.
And we hope you're having a great evening so far. It's been wonderful to hear from everyone and see all these cool experiments. And as we move forward to our final few segments of the evening, I just want to say again, thank you so much for your support. The programs that you've seen here tonight, they really wouldn't be possible without you. And we really look forward to seeing you back on the piers and here in the museum very soon. For our final science experiment, we will explore a topic that's been on all of our minds recently. We are talking about fireworks. You see them and we hear them every year, but do you really know the science behind their mesmerizing colors and their beautiful patterns? We are joining Exploratorium scientist Ron Hipschman to find out.
Welcome to Full Spectrum Science and this special Party at the Piers short edition of How Fireworks Work. I'm your host, Ron Hipschman, and once the Exploratorium opens again and you can come and visit, we hope you'll come and see the full-length presentation. So let's get started here. Gunpowder, invented in 8th century China, has three primary ingredients: potassium nitrate, which provides the oxygen for the mixture to burn, to which is added the fuel, charcoal, and sulfur in these proportions. Here are the chemical reactions when gunpowder burns. When the three ingredients in red, potassium nitrate, charcoal, and sulfur, combine, the results can be organized into two groups, The first, in yellow, are solids. You can think of these as the ash left over after the burning. More important, at least for the effect we want the gunpowder to produce, are the molecules in light blue. These are gases. Note that our original 8 molecules of gunpowder ingredients produce 11 molecules of gas, carbon dioxide, carbon monoxide, water, and nitrogen. We all know that gases take up more room than solids, 1,000 times more room. So this is what gives gunpowder its explosive qualities. A little bit of solid produces a lot of gas. Boom. To get that boom, you want the gunpowder to burn quickly. However, gunpowder on its own is not the fastest burning substance. Here, I've spread a line of it on a sheet of steel. When one end of the line is lit, it lazily burns its way to the other end. Gunpowder has an interesting property, though. For every 10 degrees Celsius rise in temperature, the gunpowder doubles its burning speed. 10 degrees hotter, double the speed. Another 10 degrees, 4 times the speed. Yet another 10 degrees, and it burns 8 times faster, and I think you see where this is going. If you keep the gunpowder contained and confined, the heat from its own reaction will exponentially increase the burn rate, and you'll get an explosion. Here, I've made a paper tube and put a little gunpowder inside. The paper tube will contain the heat and increase the burn rate. The gunpowder burns so fast, it blows much of the gunpowder out of the tube and onto the table. Now that I've gotten the basic ingredients of fireworks under our belt, I'd like to move on to one of my favorite topics, color in fireworks. Different chemical elements burn with different colors, as you see here. As a matter of fact, every element has a unique signature, its spectrum, that depends on the arrangement of its electron energy levels. This is the brilliant periodic table produced by Theodore Gray. You should absolutely visit his website, periodictable.com. He also publishes a fantastic book, The Elements, which you can purchase from the Exploratorium's online store. Here are a few spectra of elements that are commonly used in fireworks. The elements are on the left, and the color they burn is on the right. Note that each element produces a unique set of colored lines. These elements tint the flames a specific color. If you have an unknown substance, you can excite its atoms, look at the colors produced, and compare them to the known colors made by all the elements. This technique, spectroscopy, is one of the most powerful tools in the bat belt of science. Let's put some of the elements in a flame, and let's see what colors we can produce. So over here, I have some wires that I've bent little loops at the end of, and let's start with this one here. I have separate wires for the separate elements. I'm going to wet the end of this, and I'm going to put some salt with elements in it. And literally, this time, it's just salt. Salt is sodium chloride. And so we're going to be seeing the colors that sodium produces. Okay, so I'm going to use this torch, and I'm going to heat that up, and we're going to turn the lights out and see what colors sodium produces. Sodium produces this brilliant yellow. And you may be familiar with this because you've seen sodium vapor lamps, which are yellow. You used to use them on the Golden Gate Bridge. But it's beautiful and bright color. You can do this one at home by putting salt into a flame on your gas-powered stove. Obviously, you can't use an electric stove for this. Let's try another one. The next one I'm going to try is roach powder, and roach powder is boric acid, and it contains boron. So let's see what colors boron produces. I've already put some of this into another little paper cup here, so I'm going to get a little bit of that onto the end of the wire. There we go. And let's check out the color that this boron will make. Boron makes, green. Sort of the color of the Wicked Witch of the West. That's a beautiful color. I know you're all out there going, ooh, ah. Okay, the next one we're going to try is lithium. Lithium, it just looks like a white powder as well. This is lithium chloride, sort of like sodium chloride, except this is lithium chloride. Also an ingredient in antidepressants. And you'll see why, if you know what color it's going to produce, it makes me very happy. So here we go. Let's look at the color that lithium produces. Okay? Ooh, ah. That is just the prettiest red I think I've ever seen. That's why it makes me happy. Okay. There's another element that makes red that's responsible for the color of road flares, and that's strontium. But let's take a look at one more color that I have here, which is copper. This is copper sulfate. It's a beautiful blue chemical. Not a lot of chemicals have these beautiful colors associated with them, but this one does. So let's see what color copper produces. I'm going to get a little bit on the end of the loop. And I use separate loops for each of these because you don't want the chemicals mixing. Okay, and here we go. Here is copper. Oh, it's a nice green, which goes away pretty quickly. The copper burns off pretty quickly, and there's a little sodium in there that got left over, so that gives you a little bit of yellow in there. Isn't that beautiful? So that's one of my favorite things to do is colors in fireworks, and it's all due to these elements. So the fireworks that we can buy for the 4th of July contain some of those same chemicals to create the colors that we see in those fireworks. Here, what you're looking at are the safe and sane fireworks that are relatively safe enough for you and me to set off. And when you do, it looks sort of like this. Here's the type of display these make with all the colors. Those little starburst trails on the left-hand and center firework are made by adding iron filings to the mix. The red trails on the right-hand firework are made by adding carbon, which glows red hot. The variety of these is very large. Professionals make colorful set pieces by arranging tiny burning tubes called lances and lighting them all at once with a very fast burning fuse called quick match. And of course, these can be used patriotically or, as you can see here, commercially. Here, we see some brilliant colors of pyrotechnic material explosively blown into the air by a firework known as a mine. Of course, the 4th of July is known for the rocket's red glare, but the aerial displays put on by professional pyrotechnicians don't use actual rockets, like the ones you see here. These are for amateurs among us, though we can't buy these legally in the United States. Professional pyrotechnicians use shells for their aerial displays. These do not have a propulsive rocket engine to lift them into the sky. Rather, they are more closely related to an explosive cannonball. Shells are launched into the sky from mortars, basically tubes that are firmly mounted on the ground. The shells are loaded into mortars with their quick match fuses hanging over the lip of the mortar. The fuse can be lit manually, but is more commonly lit electrically, allowing the show to be computer controlled and coordinated with some sort of music program usually. Let's look at the structure of a shell and try and understand how it works. Here, we see a shell cut in half. It has many parts that all work together to make those beautiful sky bursts we ooh and ah over. First, the quick match fuse is lit. It rapidly burns until it lights a carefully measured amount of a gunpowder-like substance called the lift charge. This is what's responsible for blowing the shell out of the mortar and into the sky. The lift charge also lights the time fuse, which you see in purple here. This is a slow-burning fuse that causes a delay, waiting for the shell to reach the peak of its trajectory. Obviously, a lot of work goes into calculating the amount of lift charge necessary to get the shell to the height you want it, and the amount of time that takes, and hence the size of the time fuse you need. Once the time fuse burns through, it lights another short piece of quick match to bring the ignition to the center of the shell. Here, it lights the burst charge, which has two jobs. It must blow the shell apart, and it must light up the pieces of burning material that you see from the ground. These pieces are called stars. They're spheres in this shell, but they can be other shapes too. These burning stars are what give you the ooh-ah of the firework. Making stars is where some of the fireworks' fun comes in. Stars come in a variety of effects. Stars that change color as they burn. Stars that explode or crackle. Stars that are self-propelled and fly around. Stars that whistle. Stars that blink or strobe. And many more. Creatively arranging the stars within the shell can also create a huge variety of effects. Let's look at one of those right now and see what this shell might look like when it's set off. This is the type of display put on by the shell we just saw, the spherical shell. Beautiful chrysanthemum-shaped bursts of colored fire. This one is a bit more complicated than a normal shell. The shell you just saw was a multi-burst shell. Shells within shells. These can get very complicated to design and build, as you see here in some partially built samples. Not all shells are spheres, as you can see here, and they come in many sizes, which begs the question I know you're all thinking. What is the biggest shell? Well, in the U.S., the biggest shell allowed by Homeland Security is 12 inches in diameter. However, this is a 48-inch shell constructed in Japan. And I know you want to see what it looked like when they launched it. Here we go. You're in luck. That is one giant firework. However, another world record shell was set off at the Malta Festival in 2016. It's believed to be the single biggest firework ever. Now, I must warn you to never, ever try to build fireworks at home, and I want to show you why. I was driving down 19th Avenue in 1998 on my way to the Exploratorium, and this is what I saw. It's suspected that this disaster occurred because of illegal fireworks being built in the bottom story garage of this house. That story was demolished and disappeared, leaving the upper two stories sitting at an almost 45-degree angle. The explosion injured at least 17 people, including 6 children, and blew out windows for a block around. Luckily, no one was killed. A miracle, you'll agree. Before I show you some more shells from a Japanese competition, I'd like to thank Dave X of Burning Man for his advice, knowledge, and behind-the-scenes photos of fireworks, and the chemistry department at San Francisco State University. They are the ones that provided the chemicals that we used in the flame test. And now, some of the best shells I've ever seen from a Japanese fireworks competition. This one has some beautiful explosions on the way up, beautiful colors. And look at that multi-dimensional explosion with multiple levels inside. Moving stars, those are the stars that propel themselves and fly around. Multi-burst shell with reports, with stars that explode. This one's whistling on the way up. And a gigantic spherical burst. Sparkling stars on the way up. And a multi-level kind of strobing stars and stars with reports. Thank you. Look at all the shells, the layers in that shell. Beautiful. Sparkly stars at the end. More sparkly stars on the way up. And this one has those self-propelled stars again. They rocket around. Thank you for viewing this special Party at the Piers edition of Full Spectrum Science, How Fireworks Work, presented by the Exploratorium in San Francisco. Like all Exploratorium programs, this program depends on donors like you. We know this time is challenging, but if you can, help us keep this material available to all by donating today at give.exploratorium.edu/party. Thanks.
Hi, I'm Mo Rocca, correspondent for CBS Sunday Morning, panelist on NPR's Wait, Wait, Don't Tell Me, host of the Henry Ford's Innovation Nation, and senior explainer for Exploratorium East, also known as my New York City apartment. Let me show you around. This is the Zoom Tower of Books. The higher the tower, the better my eye line, the younger I end up looking. It's science. Thank goodness Robert Caro wrote The Power Broker. This is my lazy boy. This lever amplifies the force I apply as my body reclines. This is my position when I'm starting an exciting new Netflix series. This is my position when I'm waiting for it to get as good as it was in the beginning. You'll love this. This liquid turns the water in the bowl blue. After I scrub, the weight of the water in the tank and gravity does the rest of the work once the flush handle is engaged. You're welcome to come do this for me every Tuesday. This is a fitted sheet. Can you fold it into a square? I can't. This is my pile of old unread New Yorkers. This shows how pressure builds over time. Why else would I feel the need to read this April 2018 article on the unevenness of Paul Cézanne's portraiture? And this is the pulley I made for my fourth grade science fair. I came in second. I'm over it. Well, that's all from Exploratorium East. Please lend your support at any level to our sister institution, the Great Exploratorium of San Francisco. I'm maybe shooting this from a higher angle. I mean, I think I'd look younger.
Into your eyes before the taxi pulled away. name is Roberta Katz, and I am chair of the Exploratorium's Board of Trustees. Together with my husband, Chuck, I am also the co-chair of this year's Party at the Piers. I want to thank you so much for joining us tonight and for supporting the Exploratorium during a very challenging time. For those of you less familiar with the Exploratorium, I hope that you enjoyed tonight's introduction and that you will continue to be engaged by this very special organization, one that values science and diverse human experiences at a time when those things are ever more important. As an organization, we are working to change, evolve, and improve, and your financial support will help to ensure that we are able to reopen strongly as soon as that becomes possible. Until then, please be sure to utilize all the wonderful online educational resources available on our website. And again, I thank you most sincerely for your support.